نحمده ونصلي على رسوله الكريم أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي واجعل لي وزيرا من أهلي اللهم فكنا في الدين رب زدني علما اللهم إني أسألك علما نافعا رزقا طيبا وعملا متقبلا اللهم ألهمنا رشدا وعزنا من شرور أنفسنا اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه اللهم أرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه آمين ثم آمين. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. Dhil qurba, we mean the relations of the kin, our near and dear relatives. Quran, in more than one verse, multiple verses and multiple surahs of the Quran explain us the rights of the relations of kin over all of us. Verse number 83 of Surah Al-Baqarah, Allah highlights and explains a covenant which was taken with the people of Bani Israel, and these are the 10 commandments which were given to Hazrat Musa alayhi salam. Allah says, وَإِذْ أَخَذْنَا مِيثَاقَ بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلَ لا تعبدون إلا الله وبالوالدين إحسانا وذي القربى واليتامى والمساكين وقولوا للناس حسنا. Allah says, remember what? What Allah accepted a solemn pledge, a covenant from Bani Israel. Worship none but Allah and do good to your parents, to the relations of kin, to the orphans and poor, and speak kindly to all the people. Then in the first verse of Surah An-Nisa, we've already gone through that, and if I revise, it was said, وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ الَّذِي تَسَاءَلُونَ بِهِ وَالْأَرْحَامِ. Fear Allah, in whose name you demand your rights from each other and the bonds and ties of the relationships of kin. Then in verse number 27 of Surah Al-Baqarah, Allah, while talking about the disobedience, the fasikun or the disobedience, Allah says, who are they? الَّذِينَ يَنْقِذُونَ أَحْضَ اللَّهِ مِنْ بَعْدِ مِيثَاقِهِ وَيَقْطَعُونَ مَا أَمَرَ اللَّهُ بِهِ أَنْ يُسَلَى وَيُفْسِدُونَ فِي الْأَرْضِ أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْخَاسِرُونَ. These are the people who are the losers. So these disobedience, who are the losers? They do what? Allah says, who break the bond with Allah, who break the covenant of Allah, and then they do what? They swear what Allah has ordered to be joined. What has Allah ordered to be joined? The relations of kin. And what Allah has forbidden to be severed is the bonds of the relations of the blood relations and the relations of the womb. And then in verse 90 of Surah Nahl, Allah has highlighted the three do's and the three don'ts of Quran, and Allah says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُكُمْ بِالْعَدْلِ وَالْإِحْسَانِ وَإِيتَاءِ ذِي الْقُرْبَى وَيَنْهَى عَنِ الْفَحْشَاءِ وَالْمُنكَرِ وَالْبَغْيِ. إِنَّ اللَّهَ, there is absolutely no doubt that Allah enjoins upon you, number one, justice, doing good or ahsan, in spending, that is generosity towards your fellow beings, and Allah forbids you what is shameful. And Allah says the other three things are told, which are the don'ts of Quran. So these are the highlighted three do's of the Quran. And then in the verse number 177 of Surah Al-Baqarah, where Allah highlights the concept of being virtuous, the concept of being of piety is what Allah says, لَيْسَ الْبِرَّ أَن تَوَلُّوا وَجُوهَكُمْ كِبَلَ الْمَشْرِقِ وَالْمَغْرِبِ وَلَكِنَّ الْبِرَّ مَنْ آمَنَ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ وَالْمَلَائِكَةِ وَالْكِتَابِ وَالنَّبِيِّينَ وَآتَى الْمَالَ عَلَى حُبِّهِ ذَوِي الْقُرْبَى وَالْيَتَامَى وَالْمَسَاكِينَ. Allah says that true piety or true virtue is not turning your faces towards the east or the west, but the true piety or the true virtue is one who believes in Allah, the day of resurrection, the angels, the revelations, that is the book of Allah, and the prophets. And the concept of piety and the concept of virtue, as per the definition of virtue and piety after belief, Allah says what? وَآتُ الْمَالَ عَلَىٰ حُبِّهِ ذَوِي الْقُرْبَى وَالْيَتَامَى وَالْمَسَاكِينَ. And he spends his wealth for the love of Allah. Upon whom? Upon the relations of kin, for the orphans, and for the needy, and for the poor. So now, if I sum up the message of all these four or five verses which I have recited and which I have translated, I think I can, and you can, all of us, we can summarize that if we want to fulfill the covenant or the pledge of Allah, we want to come up to the level of a God-fearing person, and if we want to obey the do's and don'ts of Allah, and if we want to be virtuous, and if we do not want to be one of the disobedience, then what do we need to do? We need to maintain the bonds of the kin. We need to be kind. We need to be generous. We need to be helping. We need to be caring. We need to be loving. And we need to be merciful and good to the relationships of kin. Now, I will be reading out and I will be narrating a few ahadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to make us understand how important it is to maintain the relations of kin, and how very, very important it is to stop and to refrain from severing the relationships of kin. Hazrat Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala anhu reported in Bukhari that Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, قَالَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى مَنْ وَسَلَكَ وَسَلْتُهُ مَنْ قَطَعَكَ قَطَعْتُهُ. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that Allah the Rahman says that I shall keep connection with who keeps connection with the relationships of kin, and I should sever connections who severs the connections of kin. Similar words are also reported by Hazrat Abdul Rahman bin Auf radiallahu ta'ala anhu in Abu Dawud, and he says that Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took the mother's womb in his hand and he addressed it and he said that I am the Rahman, I am Rahman the merciful, and this Rahima, that is the womb of the mother, Allah named it as a Rahima, this is connected with me. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, man wasalaka wasaltahu man qata'aka qata'tuhu, Whoever will join you, I shall join him. And whoever will break you, I shall break him. When Allah comes to join somebody, he can join him with his blessings, with his bounties, with his Quran, with his guidance. And when Allah comes to break, or when Allah decides to sever somebody, he can cut off his sustenance. He can cut off or he can sever him from the source or from the root or from the channel of guidance, from the connection of Quran. So this is the importance of maintaining the relations of kin. And then Hazrat Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala anhu and Hazrat Jubair bin Mut'im radiallahu ta'ala anhu, they report in Bukhari and Muslim that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, لا يدخل الجنة قاطئٌ. Whoever violates the rights of kinship shall not go into the paradise. لا يدخل الجنة. If Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has told us that the person who is going to sever the relations of kin will not be allowed or permitted to go into Jannah, do you think he'll be able to enter the paradise? Hazrat Anas radiallahu ta'ala anhu reports in Bukhari and Muslim that Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, whoever wants to increase his sustenance, I suppose we know that everybody would want to do that. Whoever wants to increase his sustenance and that the marks of his feet remain for a longer time in the world, that is, he lives long. So if somebody wants to increase his sustenance and his worldly wealths and riches, and he wants to have a long life, what should he do? He should be kind and he should be helpful towards his relatives. So relatives and the relationships of kin, they are who are responsible and who will be decisive of whether we will be permitted to enter to Jannah, how long we will live, and how much of sustenance will we be blessed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Hazrat Abdullah bin Umar radiallahu ta'ala and who narrates in Bukhari that Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam telling us the way one has to maintain the relationships of kin is that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, the one who joins ties is not truly the one who reciprocates a kind act of the relative, but the one who joins the ties is who joins the ties even when the other severs them. So if we're just reciprocating, then this is not actually maintaining the bonds of kin. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was asked that tell us the deeds which will take us to paradise. And he said, feed the poor and hungry, join the bonds of kin, promote the salam, and offer the salah when people are sleeping. When? Salatul tahajjud. Then you will enter paradise. So maintaining the relationship of bonds will help a bondsman enter paradise, and any person who is going to sever the relationships of bond, la yadkhulul jannah. Hazrat Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala anhu narrates in Muslim that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was asked by a person one of his issues in his dealings with his relatives. He said, O Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, I have relatives. Now, you must have a keen ear to what I am going to tell you, because this is an issue which many of us might be facing. So he said that, O Messenger of Allah, I have relatives with whom I try to keep in touch, but they cut me off. I treat them well, but they are abusive to me, and I am patient and forgiving towards them, but they insult me. Now kindly instruct me, what should I do? The narrator says that Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam advised that if you are as you say, meaning that you, whatever you are claiming that you are behaving in this mannerism, then if it is actually true, if you are as you say, then it is as if you are putting hot ashes in their mouth. And Allah will continue to support you as long as you keep on doing this. And similarly, in Tirmidhi, there is a hadith that Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, what is the way of, he was asked that what is the way of saving our hereafter? And then Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told the person who asked that, you maintain ties with the one who severed it with you. You give it to one who deprived you, and you forgive the one who wronged you. So this is actually the mannerism, and this is actually the level we are supposed to maintain the relations like. In a hadith narrated in Bukhari, Prophet said, whoever believes in Allah and the Day of Judgment should maintain good relations with his relatives. So it is a matter of perfecting our belief and faith also. There's another hadith in Bukhari when Prophet said that a Muslim is not allowed to abandon or to sever relationship with his Muslim brother for more than 3 days. So it is not permissible in Islam. And then another hadith, Prophet said that if a Muslim severed ties with another Muslim brother for a year, that is for full 1 year without any rhyme or any reason, they are not on talking terms, then Prophet said it is as if they have shed each other's blood. Did we realize how important it is and how forbidden it is to sever these bonds? In another hadith, Prophet said, two Muslims who have severed their relationship, when they meet, the one who proceeds in salam will be closer to the blessings, bounties and pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the one who proceeds with salam and lets go the thing he was angry on and the thing they were fighting with each other about. And then there's a beautiful promise of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in a hadith that he said that when two Muslims, they had severed their relationships of kin with each other, then the one who settles the quarrel, he will be rewarded with a palace. Imagine, he will be rewarded with a palace in the heart, in the center of the Jannah. رَبِّ بْنِي لِعِنْدَكَ بَيْتًا فِي الْجَنَّةِ. Allah says, وَالصُّلْحُ خَيْرٌ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, help us all understand all this. Help us all remember all this. Help us all believe all this. Help us all act according to all this. So it's not just the words of the hadith which is going to tell us all this. I'll be narrating some incidents of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam sunnah as well. How did he behave and how did he relate with his relations of kin? We see the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam praying for his relatives. He used to pray for Hazrat Hamza radiallahu ta'ala anhu to embrace Islam. He used to pray for his uncle Hazrat Abu Talib to pray to accept Islam. And then his cousin, his paternal cousin Hazrat Abdullah bin Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhu, who was the son of his uncle Hazrat Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he prayed for him, and so many times did he pray for them. When he was born, Hazrat Abdullah bin Abbas, when he was born, his mother came and she put the baby, laid the baby in Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's lap, and then he prayed for him. Allahumma faqqihhu fid-deen. Oh Allah, bless him with the knowledge of the religion of Islam. Then when Hazrat Abdullah bin Abbas with his father migrated from Makkah to Medina, on receiving them, Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam hugged him tight. held him close to his chest, and he was supplicating, Allahumma faqqihhu fid-deen, O Allah, bless Abdullah bin Abbas with a deep-sighted knowledge and comprehension of Islam. Then, a night when he was staying with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam at his home, he got up at the time of Salatul Tahajjud. Then he held him close to his chest and he prayed, Allahumma faqqihhu fid-deen. And you know what? The supplications and du'as of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam for Hazrat Abdullah bin Abbas were accepted, and he was called as the Hibrul Ummah, the scholar of the Ummah of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So that is what we need to do for our relatives. Pray for them, because you know the best gift a Muslim brother can give his Muslim brother is the gift of a dua, the gift of a prayer or a supplication. Then Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was so loving and caring and kind and protective and tolerant and merciful to his relatives. I can narrate that incidence of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam with one of his uncles after the Battle of Badr. In the Battle of Badr, there were 70 Meccans who were killed and there were 70 who were taken captives. And one of them being the uncle of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Hazrat Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhu. He had not accepted Islam till then. And the companions narrate that it was the night after the battle that we were observing that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was not comfortable. He was restless. That is, he was just turning and tossing and couldn't just sleep. And we asked him that what was the matter and why was he so upset? And Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that it is because I'm getting upset because I am listening to the moaning and the cries of my uncle Abbas, and they are making me restless and upset. I would stop here and tell you who he was. An uncle whom Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had been inviting for belief and for faith, and had been inviting him towards Islam for the last so many years, and he had rejected the invitation of his nephew. Not only this, that he had not just accepted the invitation of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam for embracing Islam, he was among his bitter enemies. From all the way to Mecca, he had come with the Meccan army to actually fight with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, his companions. This uncle, when he is crying and when he is upset, Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is upset and he can't sleep, he's sleepless. We just need to stop and think, what are we doing? Where do we stand? Do we know who of our relatives is upset? Do you or I know, or we try to find out, or are we aware of who amongst our relatives of kin have been crying through the night? And if we know that any of our relatives is upset, then how upset are we? How sleepless have we been because of the anxieties and tensions and distresses of our relations of kin? And then we claim to be the people of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We look forward to the intercession of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam on the day of resurrection. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was so upset, and the companion said that what we did was that we just let Hazrat Abbas loose and we opened up all the chains, and then obviously he stopped. Immediately till the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked, he inquired, why is he silent now? And the companions told that thinking about your discomfort and your being upset and your anxiety and your sleeplessness, we've released him and we've opened up all the chains. Now remember, what justice, what remarkable justice. Prophet said, and he ordered, now either you chain him up or you let loose, or you let loose all the prisoners. This is a remarkable justice. And then what happened the next morning, Hazrat Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhu was all injured and bleeding and all his clothes were torn. So the Prophet asked the people of Medina, anybody, to give him his clothes. But he was very tall and nobody's clothes would fit him. And Prophet Prophet's uncle was given his clothes by Abdullah bin Ubay, the leader of the hypocrites, because he was tall also. And then you know what happened? After quite a few years, when Abdullah bin Ubay died, his son came over to the Prophet ﷺ and he requested him to give his shirt for the coffin and for the funeral of his father, fearing about his father's hypocrisy and fearing about his life after. He requested the Prophet ﷺ to give his shirt, and Prophet ﷺ took off his shirt. And there was Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and he said, oh Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, are you going to give your shirt to a person who was a hypocrite, who was the leader of the hypocrites? Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, oh Umar, don't you say that. You know, Abdullah bin Ubay gave off his shirt to my uncle Abbas when nobody's shirt would fit him. What is this? This is open-heartedness and open-mindedness. And this is acknowledging the goodness and the kindness of a person. And not just only acknowledging and accepting and mentioning and talking about the kindness of somebody, but in fact repaying and returning the kindness of the person who was kind to us. And more so, Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is trying to repay the kindness of a person who was kind to his relatives even. What are we doing? There are times in our life when we get so hard-hearted and we get so tight. Allah said, وَمَنْ يُوقَ شُحَّ النَّفْسِ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُفْلِحُونَ. We get so tight-hearted and so narrow-minded that we stop acknowledging what kindness anybody has done to us. Let aside repaying the kindness, we don't even have the heart to accept, to acknowledge and to mention the kindness somebody did to us. This is the model of excellence of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And then I read about the conquest of Mecca, when Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is riding the camel, the she camel, and he was entering Mecca. Can you imagine who was sitting behind him? This was like one of the biggest days, the biggest success in the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. 8 years after migrating from Mecca, he is walking in as the conqueror of Mecca. Couldn't have been a bigger achievement. Couldn't have been a bigger day of success for him. And behind him on his she camel is whom? The son of Hazrat Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhu, his paternal cousin. This is the message of what and how we are supposed to relate to our relatives. And we see in the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, him giving importance to his paternal relatives. Conquest of Mecca, Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is in his house, the house of Hazrat Hani radiallahu ta'ala anha. And she walks in and she talks to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and explains her situation. that she has given shelter to one of the few Meccans, but her brother Hazrat Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he is taken out his sword, he's hanging them on their heads, and he's saying that he's going to cut off their heads, he's going to behead them. And help me, because I have given them promise, I promised them to give them shelter. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, whom Ummehani has given shelter, we have given shelter. We shall provide shelter to the person whom Ummehani has promised to provide shelter. Teaches us the importance of women in Islam. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had the patience, had the time to listen to a Muslim woman. He had patience, he had the time, he had the tolerance. This was like, and this might have been like one of the most busy days of his life. But he had the patience and the tolerance, and he gave enough the time to listen to his she cousin. And he would honor her, he would respect her. There are so many incidences in the life of the Prophet ﷺ when he is being seen giving importance to his paternal relatives. But today, very, very pathetically would I highlight that moms of today, what they are doing is that they try to pump their children against her in-laws. Believe you me, this mother, this mom who is pumping their children against her in-laws in envy, in hard feelings, is the worst enemy of her children. The mother, the mom who develops a feeling of hatred, who is developing and who is instilling hatred in the hearts of her children against her grandparents, their paternal grandparents, the sole purpose of whose life is now to pray for their grandchildren. The worst enemy of the children is their mother, who is poisoning their minds and their brains against the paternal aunts and uncles, the sincerest relationships on the earth. Where can we get sincerity? Can you buy love out of money? And then we see the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam not only relating to his maternal or his paternal relations of kin, we see him being good and kind and polite even to his in-laws. Hazrat Isma radiallahu ta'ala anha, she was his sister-in-law. And there's so many times when he used to go to her house, he used to advise her, he used to instruct her. There's an occasion when he is talking to Hazrat Isma, and she was spending, and she was taking out the money from her kitty, and then she was counting the remaining, and then she was counting what she was going to give. And Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam instructed her to be generous. Stop counting. Allah will stop counting. And stop stopping. Allah will start stopping. So instructing her to be generous. Hazrat Abdullah bin Umar, Hazrat Isma radiallahu ta'ala anha was the sister of Hazrat Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, and she was Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's sister-in-law. And then Hazrat Abdullah bin Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he was the brother of Hazrat Hafsa radiallahu ta'ala anha and the son of Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and he was the brother-in-law of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We find so many times that he is coming over to the house of his sister and visiting the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and we go through a hadith in Bukhari when Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was asking him to start reciting, to start offering the Salatul Tahajjud. And then in Bukhari we read of an occasion when Hazrat Maymuna radiallahu ta'ala and his nephew Hazrat Abdullah bin Abbas is staying over for the night, when Hazrat Maymuna radiallahu ta'ala and his was she was having a turn of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam staying at her place. So this is the open-mindedness, this is the love, and this is the justice, and this is the kindness with all the relatives. Now, before I proceed, I would want to highlight, and I would want all of us to understand that who actually are the relations of kin. They are our blood relations. They are the relations by the womb of the mother, the father, brothers and sisters, uncles, aunts, may they be paternal or maternal, and the nieces and nephews. So these are the relations of the kin which I'm talking about, or the Quran is ordering us about. The next, we all need to understand, I'll be highlighting a few points, that how do we need to relate and behave with them. First of all, we need to spend on them, give them our hard-earned money. It is an order of the Quran. As I just recited the ayah, وَآتُ الْمَالَ عَلَىٰ حُبِّهِ ذَوِ الْقُرْبَىٰ, giving them money, spending on them, being generous on them, just sheer out of the love of Allah to the relations of kin. So this is an order of Allah. And Allah says, as we read, we just went through the verse number 90 of Surah Nahl, Itai dhal qurba is one of the dues of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah says, وَآتِ ذَلْ قُرْبَى حَقَّهُ, that give your relations and your relatives as if it is their right, as if it is their due right. So what do we give? We give them the zakat. We give them zakat. If any of our relatives of kin are needy, and secondly, righteously deserving of zakat, then the first right of anybody's zakat will be for his relations of kin. When it was asked in Surah Baqarah, Yasaluna kamaza yunfiqoon, they asked, what must we spend and whom must we spend on? Yasaluna kamaza yunfiqoon, ul anfiqoo. Allah said, spend on your parents, on your relatives of, and your relations of kin. So if they are needy and they are duly and rightly deserving of zakat also, then they have the first right of zakat. Now here I would want to clarify another point as well, that there are certain scholars today who are saying that a man cannot give zakat to his relations of kin. No, it is not so. There's a specific circle, obviously, whom he cannot. Which is the circle? The circle around a man of the people for whom it is obligatory for him to fulfill their economic requirements. Like a husband is supposed to fulfill the economic requirements of his wife and her, and his children. Similarly, a man is duty bound, and it is obligatory for him to fulfill the requirements of his old parents, the mother and the father, or his sister who is divorced or widowed and she comes back to him. So these are the duties of the man, and it is obligatory for him to pay for all of these. So this circle, obviously, since it is obligatory for him to fulfill their monetary requirements, then he will not be giving zakat to any one of these in this circle. But other than this circle, outside this circle, if it is his brother, he can give zakat to his needy brother, his poor uncle, his deserving niece or nephew. He can definitely give zakat to any one of them. Again, I repeat, if they are needy and if they come up to the merit of a person who deserves zakat and who can take zakat or who can be given zakat. But on the contrary, a Muslim woman who in Islam has been allowed and permitted to have property and wealth of her own, if she is giving zakat out of her money, then a Muslim woman, as she, it is not obligatory for her to fulfill the economic needs of anybody around her. She has no economic commitments whatsoever according to Islam. So since she is not supposed to pay for anybody, then if she is paying zakat out of her wealth, she can pay to any person. A woman can give zakat to her father, to her brother, to her husband, to her son, to any relative around her, provided the person is needy and deserving of zakat. And it is not my opinion. I will narrate a hadith. Hazrat Abdullah bin Masood's wife, there was Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was sitting with his companions, that a companion came and he asked, that a woman has asked that she has to pay zakat, and would it be permissible for her to pay zakat to her husband's children, that is to her stepchildren? Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam asked the person who was questioning that, who is this lady? He said, it is Zainab. Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam further inquired, which Zainab? The person said, Zainab, who is the wife of Hazrat Abdullah bin Masood radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And when Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam understood precisely who she was, then Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, tell her she can. And then he added that tell her that if she spends on his children, then she will be rewarded. She will have a double reward. She will be rewarded twofold. One, for paying her zakat and spending her wealth in the path of Allah. And the second will be to support her relatives. So a Muslim woman can spend zakat on any of the relatives around her, but the man beyond that circle, which I have explained, can definitely give zakat. And Allah when says, وَإِتَاءِ ذَلْقُرْبَى حَقَّهُ, we are supposed to give it as if it was their due right. Now the next thing is that if they do not come up to the merit of a person who can be given zakat or who can take zakat, then if they are needy and they are in an economic crisis, then we can give them the supererogatory charity or sadaqat, which is beyond zakat. And if they are not even needy and they do not need our zakat or sadaqat, and they are affluent and they are affording, even then we spend on them, and we spend to give them gifts. For Prophet ﷺ said, tahabu wa tahadu, you interchange gifts to increase the bond of love amongst each other. So exchanging gifts, give them gifts. So this was the first thing which we need to do with our relatives. Giving them money in any form or the other. Then giving them time. We need to give time to our relatives. In the world of today, we have time for everything in the world. Going about in the shopping malls, doing winter shoppings, going about dining out, hoteling out, eat as much as you can, and what not. Going about socializing to our friends, going about see the world. But in the world of today, in the selfish, in the conceited, in the egoistic, in the self-centered world of today, we don't have time for our relatives. Give them time. Give them importance. Like the incidents of the Prophet ﷺ you've heard. Give them time. Give them importance. Pray for them. Make dua for them. This is the best gift Just think, when was the last time I actually prayed for my brother or for my sister or for my niece, my nephew, my uncle or my aunt, the way I pray for myself, the way I pray for my son or my daughter, the way I pray for my husband? That is the way we pray for our intimate family. Do we ever take out time? So we need to pray for them and remember them in our prayers and our du'as and our supplications. Then we need to give them. What are we giving them, number one? I repeat again, give them your money. Give them your zakat. Give them your zakat. Give them gifts. Give them time. Give them importance. Give them du'a. And give them advice. Give them your heartfelt, sincere advice. Give them guidance. Be sincere to them. Give them your help. Give them your support. Give them your love. Give them your care. Extend helping hands. Be caring. Be kind. Be loving. Be generous. Be tolerant. Be patient and be merciful, but do not do what? These were the do's I said. This was the list of do's we have to do with the relatives. And now the list of don'ts. Do not misbehave. Do not mistreat. Do not be ill-tempered. Do not be bad-mannered. Do not make fun of them. Do not call them with bad names. Do not slander, do not backbite, do not dishonor them, do not hurt them. There are so many hard and cruel things a relative can do to a relative. We do not have to do any one of that. We have to put a stop to all of those. Allah, help us remember all this. Help us remember the importance and help us believe the importance of all this. Help us adopt all this. Help us adopt all the do's and help us stop ourselves and help us refrain from all the don'ts. Help us be merciful and kind and polite and soft-hearted and generous and sincere and loving and and caring and merciful to all those relatives around us. Fi amanillah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu.